Now there is different opinion between the Shafi'is and the majority whether reading Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim at the beginning of the prayer loudly or not. The Shafi'is say when you start the prayer, when you say Allahu Akbar and then you start reading, you say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. The others say no. You don't say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, you start straight away Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, you say it silently. And they use different hadith. I will give you one hadith that says, now, the majority agree that Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim must be read. It's only the different opinions whether it has to be read loudly or slowly. Quietly. Yeah. Now, Abu Huraira asked the Prophet, he said, when you read, when you start the prayer, between your takbir and your starting of the reading, what do you say? The Prophet said, I say, Subhanaka Allahumma ba'id bayni wa bayna khatayaya kama ba'adta bayna al-mashriq wa al-maghrib. Allahumma naqqini min khatayaya kama yunaqqa thawb al-abyadu min al-danas. Allahumma aghsilni min khatayaya bil ma'i wa thalji wa al-barad. He never said, I say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. From this hadith I understand that the Prophet used to say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim loudly. Because if he, Abu Huraira is asking him, what do you say between your reading, your recitation, and between takbir and recitation? What do you say? And he told him, he say this. But he never said, I say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. That's because Abu Huraira used to hear Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. That's why he didn't say it. It's not in the hadith doesn't mention it, but we understand it. So this is the understanding, the mafhum. The mafhum here is fiqh, understanding, how someone can understand hadith. This is definitely acceptable by everybody. But there is one understanding that we don't accept here. The ahnaf don't accept it, the zahiris don't accept it. It's called the understanding of the khitab, dalil al-khitab, the mafhum mukhalafa, the understanding of the opposite. Walaykum as-salam wa barakatuh. The understanding of the opposite. If the Prophet says something, gives a rule for something, the things that he have not mentioned, it has to be to take the opposite rule. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, وَالْخَيْلَ وَالْبِغَالَ وَالْحَمِيرَ لِتَرْكَبُوهَا وَزِينَ. The horses, the mules, the donkeys, so you ride them, and its beauty. He never mentioned eating. So the eating must be opposite. So you shouldn't eat. This mafhum here, this is what we call the opposite of qiyas. Qiyas is called by some people, some kind of qiyas is called mafhum al-muwafaqa, the understanding of the
situation.
No, not muwafaqa is agreement. It agrees. The understanding here agree with the mantuq, the one that the thing that has been said, and the thing that you have to you understand are similar. وَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفٍّ. Don't tell them uff. Meaning, don't beat them. This is the qiyas. So the mafhum muwafaqa. If he says don't beat them, he meant don't. If he says don't say off, he meant don't beat them as well. This is qiyas. Yeah, it will be mafhum mukhalafa if he say don't say off, we stop there, and we do the opposite. Anything else, it's halal. Now you tell me, okay, so you have to take one of these. No, you don't have to take one of these. Actually, the ahnaf take qiyas, but they don't take mafhum mukhalafa. Ahnaf, all the ahnaf don't take mafhum mukhalafa. The zahir is don't take qiyas and don't take mafhum mukhalafa. They say, when Allah mentioned, when Allah say, وَالْخَيْلَ وَالْبِغَالَ وَالْحَمِيرَ لِتَرْكَبُوهَا, the horses and the mules and the donkeys, so you ride them and its beauty, You say, this is what we understand from here. We don't understand anything else. Eating, we will have to find it out. We will have to look at it. We will have to go to a statement. We will have to go to Quran and look to find out if it's halal or haram. So if we go to Quran and if we go to Quran and Sunnah, we will find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا. He created for you whatever on the land. Eat, كُلُوا مِمَّا فِي الْأَرْضِ حَلَالًا طَيِّبًا. Eat from what is on the land, halal. So the horses will be included. And the mules and the donkeys, except that the donkeys, when we go to the Sunnah, the Prophet said, has forbidden the eating of the donkeys, and he said it's ritz. Ritz, that means impure, khabith, not clean. So it's haram. So we don't take it neither from qiyas, neither from the understanding of the opposite, which is the opposite of qiyas. We don't understand anything, we don't use qiyas, and we don't use the opposite. I'll give you more examples. Because mafhum mukhalafa as well is divided into like categories, like the mafhum mukhalafa of the numbers, of the ghaya, what we call it, ghaya, and the shart. I will try to translate every one of these words. The ghaya is the place where you go. If you are going to place the goal, you are going to a place you call this is Ghaya.
Destination.
Target. This means target or destination or whatever. Now I give you this example. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَإِن طَلَّقَهَا فَلَا تَحِلُّ لَهُ مِن بَعْدُ حَتَّى تَنْكِحَ زَوْجًا غَيْرَهُ. If he divorces her, then she is haram for him until she marries another man. Now when a man divorces a wife, his wife, for the third time, she is forbidden for him until she marries someone else. They say, when she marries, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, until she marries another, until she, the mafhum of, فَلَا تَحِلُّ لَهُ حَتَّى تَنْكِحَ زَوْجًا غَيْرَهُ, then she is forbidden for him until she marries another man. She says, when she marries another man, meaning she is halal for him. Yeah? So, that is not true. It's after she divorced or he dies or something. Yeah. So this is ayah. It's not. It's wrong to say this mafhum al-ghaya. What you call mafhum al-ghaya of destination, that you can use it until she marries another man. Okay. When she marries another man, can she marry her husband again? No, she can't. Either until he divorces her, or he dies, or her marriage gets annulled for some reasons, then she can marry him. So this is battle. Some people try to say that La ilaha illallah is mafhum mukhalafa. La ilaha illallah. Actually, many people say this, but those who know Arabic, those people like Khalil al-Khalil, like Ibn Malik, like even Shanqiti, those people who speak Arabic properly, they say there is no mafhum mukhalafa here. Mukhalafa, mafhum mukhalafa is something you understand but it's not mentioned. And you, the understanding of the opposite. They say la ilaha illallah, meaning we understand it's the opposite. From this statement, we understand that Allah is the ma'bud, the true ma'bud. That's not true. La ilaha is mantuq. Is this said? La ilaha, there is no God. Illa Allah. It is said. So you don't understand it. It's not mentioned, but you understand it. No, it is said. And this is actually the people of Arabic language, the people of the Arabs, don't say this. It's the usuliyin who say it. And Arabic, you take it from the Arabs.
Sure. Would this be the negation and affirmation? the negation and affirmation for.
No, it's not. Here, لا إله إلا الله and محمد رسول لا إله إلا الله is a negation, negating and affirming. Yeah, but it has nothing to do with مفهوم المخالفة. There is another thing here, مفهوم المخالفة. The way they divide it, they say the مفهوم of غاية, destination, and then the other one is الشرط, the مفهوم of شرط, the condition. وإن كنا أولات حمل فأنفقوا عليهن حتى يضعن حملهن. When someone, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Surah Al-Talaq, if you divorce them, when you divorce women, if they are carrying something, I mean they are pregnant, then spend on them until they deliver their load. I mean until they deliver the baby. You have to spend on them. They say the opposite, the understanding of opposite, if they are not carrying anything, then you don't have to spend on them. You understand? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, if they are carrying, if they are pregnant, this woman, you have to spend on them. The opposite is, if they are not carrying anything, if they are not pregnant, you don't have to spend on them. So they take it from مفهوم المخالفة. We don't take it from مفهوم المخالفة, we agree with this, but every Muslim's property is sacred. It's haram, forbidden for anybody. Nobody has to spend money on anybody else except by the order of Allah. So this man has not been ordered anywhere. We look in the Quran and Sunnah, we didn't find that Allah has ordered him to spend on the woman that he has divorced. He is ordered to spend on his wife. Now he divorced her. She is not his wife anymore. We can't tell him go and spend on other woman. And this is another woman now. She is not his wife anymore. Allah ordered him to spend on her as long as she is his wife. When she is not his wife, he doesn't have to spend on her. So even if there was no this ayah that says that if they are carrying pregnant from you, you have to spend on them. If without this ayah, we will tell him, no, your relation to this woman is finished. You don't have to spend on her. So we didn't take it from this specific ayah. We took it from the hadith that says that every Muslim property is sacred, is haram for others, except with his willing. You understand? The other one is the mafhum al-adad, the understanding of the numbers. For example, when the Prophet says, whatever Muslim dies, and 40 people pray janazah on him, all of them asking Allah to forgive him or to the intermediate intercede for him, Allah will accept their intercession. Doesn't mean if someone dies and less than 40 people intercede that Allah will not accept their intercession. All of these, for the people who accept مفهوم المخالفة, they have different opinions. For example, the majority don't accept مفهوم العدد. About the numbers, they don't accept. The majority don't accept it. The majority say, yeah, doesn't. If he say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say 40, less than 40 doesn't mean that it's the opposite. It's possible that less than 40, Allah still accept their intercession. So they don't accept that about the numbers. There is another مفهوم المخالفة which has which nobody takes. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say Muhammadur Rasulullah, does it mean Isa is not Rasulullah? Because Muhammadur Rasulullah, does it mean anybody else is not Rasulullah? Musa and Isa, and this one nobody accepts it, this kind of مفهوم مخالفة. The truth is, all مفهوم المخالفة, all the understanding of the opposite are not acceptable. Some people say, okay, if these words are mentioned Like Shafi'i, for example, say that the animals, the sheep that are being fed. You see, some people have sheep. They just let them go to the field. Grace. Some people, they have the sheep, they put them in place and they buy food for them. We call this sa'ima. The one that goes to the field is called sa'ima. The graze, the grazing ones. Now the Prophet said in many statements that sheep, there is zakat in sheep. Like in every 40 sheep, there is one sheep you have to give. Many hadith, general, that for every 40 you have to give one. General, doesn't say the one that grazes or the one that don't graze. But there is one hadith that says, "Fi sa'imati al-ghanam zakat," that the grazing sheep, there is zakat in them. Now what do you say? Shafi'i say, if they are not grazing, if you feed them, if you buy food for them, you don't pay zakat. The opposite. If the Prophet say, the grazing one, there is zakat in them, meaning the ones that don't graze, huh? The one that you buy food for, you don't have to pay zakat for them. This is the understanding of the opposite. When you don't agree, they will say, why the Prophet will mention this word if it has no benefit? Well, the Prophet will say that the grazing one, if he want to say everything. The Prophet will say that maybe for many reasons. One reason is that someone will come to the Prophet and say, is there zakat? Is there any zakat in the sheep that are grazing? And he will answer it. He will answer that specific question. Now when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَوْلَادَكُمْ خَشْيَةَ إِمْلَاقٍ, don't kill your children out of fear of poverty. The understanding of the opposite will say that kill them for other reasons. This is the understanding of the opposite. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تُكْرِهُ فَتَيَاتِكُمْ عَلَى الْبِغَاءِ إِنْ أَرَدْنَا تَحَصُّنَا. Don't force your slave girls into committing adultery if they want to be chaste. So if they don't want to be chaste, do we force them to commit adultery? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, إِنَّ اللَّهَ بِهِمْ إِنَّ رَبَّكَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ بِهِمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ لَخَبِيرٌ إِنَّ رَبَّكَ بِهِمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ لَخَبِيرٌ. Surah Al-Adiyat. Help me. Yeah? إِنَّ رَبَّهُمْ بِهِمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ لَخَبِيرٌ. Their Lord will know them that day. Will be informed by them that day, the day of judgment. What about before that day? This is from Mukhalafa. This is what is the opposite of Qiyas. Sure. Now, yeah.
What school of thought will accept this, though, Sheikh?
I know what you're saying. Mafhum Mukhalafa.
No, I know what you're saying.
The Mafhum Mukhalafa is accepted by the Malikis, the Hanbalis, and the Shafi'is. But, you know, but not the Hanafis.
But the examples you're giving.
Yeah. No, but they don't say it.
Yeah.
No, nobody will say this.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah.
That's what I'm saying here. What I'm saying is, when you have the Mafhum, how it works, Mafhum Mukhalafa and the Qiyas are two the opposite things. That there is no rules. You can pick and choose. Here I do qiyas, here I do mafhum mukhalafa. What you do here is, this is wrong and this is wrong. You have to go back to the dalil. You have to go back to the proof. Always, everything, you go back to the dalil and look for it in Quran. Of course, you may see that you are, everybody agrees about the what they say. This ayah here, we come to the same conclusion. But the way you the route you have taken. Because if you take a route, you have to take it all the time. If this is a rule that you use in religion, you have to use it all the time. This is a word that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Quran, those who say, okay, if this word doesn't mean this, okay, what does it mean? Why Allah will say it? Many of these people will come to a word that Allah has said where you should take it, and then they don't take it. See, Ibn Abbas, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say in Quran, يستفتونك قل الله يفتيكم في الكلالة. They ask you for fatwa. Say that Allah will give you fatwa according regarding kalala. Kalala is someone who dies and has no
heritage.
Ascendance or descendants.
Okay.
No father, no grandfather, and no children. No children. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say inimru'un, and then he explains more. إِنِمْرُؤٌ هَلَكَ لَيْسَ لَهُ وَلَدٌ. If a man dies and has no children, إِنِمْرُؤٌ هَلَكَ لَيْسَ لَهُ وَلَدٌ وَلَهُ أُخْتٌ فَلَهَا نِصْفُ مَا تَرَكَ. And he has a sister, she will have half of the inheritance. And he mentioned about the brothers and the sister, what they will take. So it is a condition that the sister and the brothers, or the sisters or the brothers and sisters, will take only when there is no children. إِنْ إِمْرُؤٌ هَلَكَ لَيْسَ لَهُ وَلَدٌ. If a man dies and has no children, then the sisters and the brothers can take inheritance. Some people used to say that if someone dies and he has a daughter, she will take half. And if he has a sister, in this case the sister will take half. But in this case he has a daughter, so he has children. And Ibn Abbas used to say, أَأَنْتُمْ أَعْلَمُ أَمِ اللَّهِ. You know better or Allah? Allah say, if someone dies and he has no children, you say, even if he has children. This is a word that you have to take, because there is nowhere, you can't find hadith sahih, even though there is hadith which is in Bukhari from Ibn Mas'ud that says, but it's not really clear that the Prophet said it, and it's the narration of Abdurrahman ibn Tharwan. Abdurrahman ibn Tharwan narrated hadith about the Prophet wiping on his socks, and everybody say it's da'if. So if he's da'if here, it's da'if here as well. There is hadith that where he says that the girls will take inheritance the sisters will take with the daughters. Ibn Abbas doesn't agree with this, because there is no hadith sahih from the Prophet. And the ayah says that when someone dies and has no children, then the sister will have half. If he has sisters and brothers, they will be partners in the inheritance. So this is a word that you have to take. There is another place, another example here. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَإِنْ طَلَّقَهَا فَلَا تَحِلُّ. We go back to that example. فَإِنْ طَلَّقَهَا فَلَا تَحِلُّ لَهُ مِنْ بَعْدُ حَتَّى تَنْكِحَ زَوْجًا غَيْرَهُ. If he divorces her, then she is not lawful to him until she marries, look, حَتَّى تَنْكِحَ زَوْجًا غَيْرَهُ. Now we spoke before about the word in Arabic, any word that has two meanings, that we have to take the whole meanings except with proof. حَتَّى تَنْكِحَ زَوْجًا.
Just a marriage and have relation.
No. Until تَنْكِحَ زَوْجًا غَيْرَهُ. Yes. To marry. And now if we say, according to the majority who say the word نَكَحَ means زَوَاج rather than relation, meaning marriage rather than relation, having relation, sexual relation, then it will have no meaning. In Arabic, when you say she marries a husband, of course she marries a husband. So the Arabs will consider this talk to be fluent talking. Huh? When you say a woman married a man, Of course, she's not going to marry a dog. So she married, you can say she married Muhammad, she married Sa'id. Huh? This is more information, they will know who she married. But to say a woman married a man, it has no benefit. A fluent person like the Prophet will not say this. Quran will not say she married a husband. Of course, when she marries someone, she is here, حتى تنكح زوج غير, and then here, what is the benefit of this word if you don't use it? This word is beneficial here. حتى تنكح زوج غيره, meaning if this woman, if the man divorces a woman and she commits adultery, if you tell me what's the meaning, تنكح زوجا, and he didn't say تنكح only. Because if she commits adultery, then it's not enough. If she is a slave and she goes back to her owner and she has a relation with him, it's not enough. She must marry someone and have a relation with him.
Really?
Yes.
That's what it's saying, isn't it? Having a relation with your husband. It doesn't say just have a relation.
Yeah, have a relation with a husband. And this is actually what the Prophet has said. When a woman, there is hadith in Bukhari, a woman was married to someone called Rifa'a, and then he divorced her 3 times. Then she went and married someone called Abdurrahman bin Zabir. And then she didn't like to stay with him. She went to the Prophet and she wanted to get back to the first one. The Prophet said, do you want to go back to Rifa'a? No, until you test his honey and he tests yours, meaning having a relation, sexual relation. This is what the Prophet told this woman. So he explained this ayah. We have spoken before about the words in Quran, meaning that where you have to take the meaning of the word, all the meanings. And here the Prophet explained that this word here means you have to take both the meanings, not one. Of course, if we say we shouldn't take the meaning of marriage, that's because it will be in the Arabic language, it will not be fluent. And it is there. Huh? You don't need it, because when he says husband, meaning marriage. Yes?
Sheikh, you said take all the meaning.
Well, this is what everybody should say. Because if a word has two meanings, how do you know which one you are going to take? Well, you have to do ijtihad. A word has two words, and this is Arabic language. Why? What kind of ijtihad? What ijtihad? Ijtihad is this, to take to the two words.
The example you said, hatta.
Yeah.
There is in another hadith, يتزوجها أو ينكحها.
Yeah.
إنما الأعمال بالنيات.
Yeah.
This hadith.
Yeah.
Some of them they took يتزوجها.
Yeah. Then. What has this hadith to do with this? The Prophet said, فَمَنْ كَانْتْ هِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى دُنْيَا يُصِيبُهَا أَوْ مَرْأَةٍ يَتَزَوَّجُهَا. He definitely, he has said, either he said يَتَزَوَّجُهَا or he said يَنْكِحُهَا. Huh? And then, one of the narrators narrated it by the meaning. But here, whoever, if the Prophet said يَتَزَوَّجُهَا, the Prophet said يَتَزَوَّجُهَا or يَنْكِحُهَا. It's not possible that he said both of them. You understand? So if he said يَتَزَوَّجُهَا, then زَوَاج mean only marriage. If he said يَنْكِحُهَا, then yes, some people may do hijra to go and get married. Some people do hijra to get to do zina, to do adultery. In all cases, it's haram to do hijra for this. If you do hijra to get married, you will get no reward for that. If you go do hijra to get to for zina, you will get the ithm. Of course, if the word was it yankihuha, all this hadith is it won't make big difference if you take this meaning or this. All we know from this hadith that is your deeds are according to their intention. So if you do, if you do your hijrah for to marry a woman, or you do hijrah to get some money, or that's what you will get. You will get nothing else. It's this hadith is really not something that we can take. I can give you my better example here. You see, when Allah Subhanahu wa Taala said, "Wa la tankihu ma nakahu abaukum min an-nisa," same word. Don't do nikah with the woman that your parents or have done nikah with. Parents mean fathers, your fathers. That's mean your father, your grandfather, your great grandfather. Now, will you say that don't get married to the woman that your parents are married to? Or will you say that you don't have relation as well with the people, with the woman that your parents have relation with? What do you say about this? Do you take the two meanings or only one?
Only one.
Only one. That don't get married to the...
I had this, some alim, I don't know what's his name.
Okay.
He took one meaning.
Okay. Let me talk about your alim then. If someone has a slave, and he had a relation with her, and then he died, and his son inherited his slave, do you say that he will have relation with the slave? Or it's haram? Someone had a relation, is not married to a woman, had a relation with his slave, which is halal in Sharia, and then he dies. This woman that he has a relation with is a slave, is money, property. So his son will inherit her. She becomes his property. Will you say that she is halal for the son after the father had a relation with her? Huh? What's the answer?
We'll take the ayat that says,
وَلَا تَنْكِحُوا مَا نَكَحَ آبَاؤُكُمْ, meaning don't have a relation with the woman that your parents. So you are taking the two meanings. So you're contradicting your alim here. Actually, the majority here, not the majority, it's considered to be ijma', I think. Nobody has said that someone can have relation with from this ayah. This ayah, we take it from ijma'. Well, this ijma' is based on the ayah. The ijma', people will not ijma' from their head. The words in Quran, any word in Quran, in that has two meanings or more, you have to take all the meanings, unless you can. Here, it's not possible for any reason. When we say, for example, about the boy, وَابْتَلُوا الْيَتَامَ حَتَّى إِذَا بَلَغُوا النِّكَاحِ, test the orphans until they reach the age of nikah. Now, you don't say until they reach the age of marriage. There is no specific age for marriage. So until they reach their age where they can have relation, because the boys can't have relation at certain time until they reach the age of puberty. That's because it's not possible. That way we don't take the one meaning. Oh, see, this is how.
Okay, you see, when you said about the slave and his son, can he have intercourse?
Yeah.
But how would you know if he had intercourse with his slave?
Well, that's what we have to know. If the father.
What can he do if he inherits? If he inherits the slave.
Yeah. He can ask her. Where there is, accept her only her word, where there is nothing, the woman will say, of course. Umar ibn Khattab, when he was dying, he told his children, this woman is not okay for you. I had relation with her. So this is what normally people will say.
Someone got killed for that, isn't it, Sheikh?
For what?
Somebody was ordered to be killed because he had
relation with her. He got married to the wife of his father.
He got married to her.
Yeah. The one that Prophet sent someone to kill him.
Yes.
Yeah. That person has... Well, when someone here, it's clearly that this man has wed a woman. You see, when someone commits zina, he will commit zina. He will hide and do it. Yeah? And not talk about it. And even if he talk about it... But when he... Okay. Celebrate it and call people, and I mean, he's making it halal. He considered to be halal. And then if you make halal haram, then you are not someone who makes halal haram is not a Muslim. So he was killed because he was not a Muslim, not because he committed zina or something. Committing zina as well for someone who is married will make his blood halal, but in a different, you kill him in a different way, of course. He will be stoned to death. Yes.
No, sorry, it's got nothing to do with
it. Yeah. It's not last. Inshallah, it's fine, because this is, I told you, it's a very small subject, and we have. This is what I want to go and say anyway. We have finished and the time is Isha.
Are you
going to
continue your next lesson about Mufhum?
Mukhalafa. No, for Mukhalafa is just, it's very simple. We are going to go through these lessons again, inshallah, from now we are going to, when we finish this summary, we are going to go through the book and take a book with someone saying things. We will read the book. And whether we agree with him or whether we disagree with them. Of course, you know, usul fiqh, except from the four, the two things that are agreed on is Quran and Sunnah. Every Muslim agree on this, that Quran and Sunnah are the source of the religion. And then ijma', different opinions about it, then qiyas, and then like ijma', Ahmed ibn Hanbal say it's invalid, and then qiyas, zahiris and Ahmed ibn Hanbal, and then qiyas, the zahiris and Ahmed ibn Hanbal say is invalid, and then mufhum al-mukhalafa, the hanafis and the zahiris say is invalid, and then the istihsan, the shafi'is and the malikis and the hanbalis and the zahiris say is invalid. Istihsan is another subject. It's a very simple thing. Is to decide that this is good, this is obligation, this is haram, this is wajib, this is wrong, based on nothing except the aql. You look at something.
Is it a bit like with Sad al-Daraya?
Yeah, it's. Maybe, but it's not. It's not even based on that. Huh? Mm-hmm. It's just you look at something. Oh, this thing is good. It should be wajib. It should be haram. It should be, and this is what many people do.
And they have a branch in the Usul al-Fiqh about this.
The Ahnaf have they do istihsan. Okay. The Shafi'i has a strong statement against it. He wrote about it. He said whoever does istihsan, he has created new. He has started new Sharia.
Istihsan.
Istihsan.
So do they all differ? Like, for example, you said that qiyas is opposite of mafhum al-mukhalafa.
Yeah.
So basically, they choose with their desire. Each madahir.
No, it's not. We don't accuse people of the desire. Some people, yeah. Some people. It is. This is what they say. When you go to Shawkani, when he says speaks about qiyas and then. When people say the Prophet used to do qiyas, even though he might agree with them that Prophet has done qiyas, which is not true. The Prophet وَمَا يَنْتَقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى, he doesn't talk out of his desire. Whatever he says is wahy. إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَى, it is revelation. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't do qiyas. The qiyas is done by people who don't know. People don't know the rule, and then they do qiyas. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if someone says Allah has done qiyas, and some people say it out of ignorance, then it's a big statement. Allah does qiyas. When you say that qiyas is for someone who doesn't know the rule, and he is comparing things and to come with the rule, the Prophet is not doing except to transmit the revelation that comes from Allah. So he's not doing qiyas as well.
So what's the strongest dalil for using mafhum mukhalif? What's the dalil that they use?
Mafhum mukhalafa.
Yeah.
It's exactly the same thing what you do from qiyas. Is that okay? Exactly. This is what people understand. This is what the majority of people are doing.
Basically.
Of course, different.
And but the Shafi'is, Hanbalis, and Malikis used it. You said
they use it in certain ways. Yeah. Not generally, but they disagree about which kind of mafhum mukhalafa they have to accept.
So they would use pick and choose.
Yeah.
Yeah. But like you're saying, if you use it this time,
you've got to use it all the time.
Of course, yeah. But they have divided the mafhum mukhalafa into, you see, many times when you come, and then people will, many cases, people will say, okay, is it qiyas here or mafhum mukhalafa? And they debate, and then they agree that it's not clear whether you have to use just based on like opinion, maybe it looks like.
So when that time we were talking about the salah, we said the ayah for intab wa qam salah wa zakat for akhwanakum fi din. You were saying it's opposite there. Is that mafhum mukhalafa?
No, no. The kafirs are not our brothers. Yes. Generally, we know the kafirs are our enemies. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لا تتخذوا عدوي وعدوكم أولياء. And then he said, until they do this. So we didn't know, understand that before they do salat and before they do zakat, they are not our brothers. We don't understand it from this ayah. We understand it from the ayah that says, لا تتخذوا عدوي وعدوكم أولياء. Don't take my enemy and your enemy as friends. We don't take it from المؤمن أخو المؤمن, meaning the kafir is not the believer. You understand? We go to another ayah. If we say that it says something similar, it says something similar. If it says something opposite, it's opposite. Yeah. It has to be either similar or opposite.
So the ayah,
but we don't take it from this specific hadith. We have to go to the other hadith and.
But the ayah that says فَإِخْوَانَكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ, that doesn't mean that before they weren't your brothers. Is that what you're saying?
No, this ayah doesn't mean that before they were not your brothers. Not this ayah. From this ayah, we don't understand that they were before our brothers or our enemies. So we have to go to Quran, and Quran will say that they were our enemies before. Not this ayah.
So if they don't pray.
Yeah, they were our enemies, but it's not this ayah that told us this.
I understand it's not the...
Yeah, it's right. the whole Qur'an. لا تتخذوا عدوي وعدوكم أولياء. And so...
If it was just for this ayah, it would show that they were...
We don't know. They were our enemies or our brothers or...
Sheikh.
Yes.
Sheikh, you say some ulama use ikhtilaf and majmua.
مفهوم المخالف.
You have to use it, you don't have to use it everywhere. You have to use it in some occasions.
Yeah, but why? What are these occasions? How?
How do you define
it? Like qiyas. You say there is a different. You have to qiyas. You use it when you don't have the belief.
No.
When you don't have the thing.
Yeah, but I am saying that there is dalil everywhere, for everything.
In some occasions.
No, there isn't. There is no some occasions. Give me an example. Okay, you go and think about it, and next time inshallah I bring an example. About the places where there is no dalil.
When did it get standardized and part of the deen? Yeah. When it became like a rule in usul fiqh? Who introduced Shafi. Was it Shafi that introduced it?
The mufhum mukhalafa.
Or were there people before doing it but they didn't say it?
Mufhum mukhalafa.
Yeah.
Mufhum mukhalafa is not known before at the as word dalil khitab, as a rule.
Yeah.
Like, it's not known, it's before Shafi'i.
So who opposed Shafi when he first, you know, for something to come out new, there must have been someone in the beginning who opposed him and said, this is what you're saying here.
We don't know who opposed him. Ibn Shafi'i in his books doesn't speak about mafhum mukhalafa the way we understand it. And these things, you know, they evolve, they change from, who opposed him or who approached him, we don't know these things. We don't know who approached Shafi'i about qiyas or about ijma' or about anything.
As it went down the line, yeah. Dawood al-Zahiri, he didn't take qiyas.
He doesn't take all of these except Quran and Sunnah.
Mm.
But Sheikh, surely if Shafi'i brought it up or invented it, that must have
We don't say he invented it. Oh. People used to do it.
Was it a minority opinion at the time?
We don't say it's a minority opinion. Mufhum mukhalafa, this is what people do. This is what people normally do. It just we say it's in a religion we shouldn't.
For nature.
People, this is what normally people do. Sometimes they understand from mukhalafa, but not where you understand from mukhalafa, I might not understand it.
Yeah.
And not religion is not left to us to understand what some people, everybody follow what he thinks and you understand.
Sure. Some hadith you take it from Buhari, and some you say, you know,
We take hadith. Not
some you accept and some no.
No, we don't say some accept and some no. We look at the isnad. Still, we look at the isnad. Allah has protected the religion, and alhamdulillah, Bukhari has brought the isnad, and it's still there. So the isnad, the chain of narrators, the man, and so we can look at them, and still decide which hadith to be accepted or which not. When we say hadith is da'if or sahih, I don't say, oh, this hadith is da'if because I don't like it. We say this hadith is da'if because this man, I will mention the name of the man, and we say that some people said he is weak. I will not even bring a hadith and say, oh, this hadith is da'if because there is man that everybody said he is tiqa, but I don't like him. I will say, Ahmed Muhammad said da'if, Ibn Ma'in said da'if, Ibn Madini said da'if. However, then some people may say tiqa. It's not possible that someone is weak and he's strong in the same time. He is either weak or strong. And then it's left for you to look and make a decision, and you say why you say this person is da'if. When I said earlier, I mentioned one hadith and said this man is weak, the hadith of Ibn Mas'ud, I said Abdul Rahman ibn Tharwan is weak. I said because this man make mistakes. And I gave an example that this man narrated a hadith that the trustworthy people said, narrated this hadith from Mughira ibn Shu'bah. They said the Prophet wiped over his khuf. This man said over his socks. And this is not something acceptable in religion, that someone make mistake like this. So this person, we can't trust him. It's not the question that he is bad. Maybe his memory is weak and he make mistakes. So you can't rely on him. Someone like this might bring hadith from Ibn Mas'ud, say the Prophet said it. There is the adhan now, inshallah, we continue next week, inshallah.